Okay, thank you. I would like to talk about second order sensitivity. So first of all, what is sensitivity? The general idea is to evaluate the effect of flow modification or control on some property of the flow. So a famous example is this experimental study by Strikowski and Srinivasan, where they moved a control device shown here in the wake of a cylinder, and they were able to obtain those maps, these kind of maps showing for different Reynolds numbers where the vortex shading is fully suppressed. So they had to test many different locations in a systematic way. And one can also use so-called adjoint methods to obtain the same results. You see here that the agreement is very good for the stabilizing region. And the big advantage, or one of the main advantages, is that you can obtain that with only one single calculation. So sensitivity analysis can be applied to a broad range of controls, steady, unsteady, optimal perturbations, shape optimization, and so on. And it can also be used for many different objective functions that you can see here, including nonlinear stability properties like limit cycle frequency and amplitude. But of course, it can also be applied to standard linear stability, so standard eigenvalues, in parallel flows, 2D flows, 3D flows. This has become very classical. So here is a bit of theory to explain how it works. If you have a linearized eigenvalue problem for the eigenvalue lambda, an eigenmode small u, linearized around the base flow, capital U, which we can write formally like this. And if you now introduce a small amplitude control, f, you will not only modify the base flow, but also the eigenmode and the eigenvalue, which can be written as a series expansion. And if you collect terms at different orders, at order one, you get the uncontrolled eigenvalue problem. And at order epsilon, you get this relation where this operator A1 depends only on the first order base flow modification. Now you can project that on the eigenmode, sorry, the adjoint mode. And you get rid of the left-hand side here, and you get this expression for the first-order eigenvalue variation, which you can also manipulate a bit so as to isolate the control on one side, and to get this so-called first-order sensitivity on the other side, which is independent of the control. It only depends on the uncontrolled base flow and uncontrolled eigenmode. And this is a vector, so you can easily plot it and visualize it. So since it's independent of the control, you can compute it once for all. Now, this is linear by construction. So what you get is typically something like this. Here you're seeing four examples where I put localized body forces along the minus x direction in different locations of the cylinder wake. So you see that the agreement is good. Slope in amplitude epsilon equals zero is usually very good. But in some cases, the agreement starts to become bad for larger amplitudes. So a natural thing to do is simply to go to a second order. If you're using the same method, you can collect terms at order epsilon square, project on the eigenmode, and you get this expression for the second order eigenvalue variation, which has two terms, but yeah, which has two terms. And you can manipulate that to isolate the control. So now it appears twice because it's a quadratic effect. And you have here the so-called second order sensitivity, which again is independent of the control. And now we obtain those green lines, green curves, and generally they are in much better agreement than the first order prediction, the red lines. We can also isolate the second order variation. If we subtract the first order, we plot it as a function of epsilon square, and we can check that the agreement, so the slope in zero, is very good. So the second order sensitivity is a tensor, it's not a vector anymore, so it's difficult to plot it and to visualize it. But still, we can evaluate it for a given form of the control. So here are the first order and second order eigenvalue variations for a localized body force along the plus x direction this time. So be careful, the curves I was showing before were for minus x. So anyway, now we can understand those curves. We see here, for instance, that those three locations, A, B, and C, they're in a region of similar first-order effects. So the three red lines here have more or less the same slope, whereas D here is in a region of very small sensitivity, so this line is almost horizontal. And then if we look at the second-order effect, we see that A, B, and D have a negative second-order effect. So the green curves here are below the red lines, whereas C is in a red region, positive region. So the green line is above the red line. And something interesting that we can obtain with this information is also the range of validity of the first-order prediction. If we consider this expansion, we see that the second-order effect will be negligible for amplitudes much smaller than this threshold amplitude, which is the ratio of lambda 1 over lambda 2. So we can obtain this kind of map here plotted in log scale. And you see that A, for instance, in a green region where the threshold amplitude is large, the agreement of the first order sensitivity with the nonlinear results is good over a wide range of amplitudes, whereas D here in this red region where the threshold amplitude is small is good only in a very narrow range of amplitudes. We can also obtain information about whether the first order sensitivity is under or overestimating the actual results. If we consider the product, lambda 1, lambda 2, so we have two planes of regions where both effects, first and second order, have the same sign. I call those regions safe, or they have opposite signs, and I call those regions dangerous. Because, as you can see here, in the safe regions, the first order prediction tells you that you should use this control amplitude to fully restabilize the flow, whereas actually you need less. So you have a conservative estimate. Whereas in dangerous regions, you actually need more to restabilize the flow, or in some cases, you may actually not be able to restabilize the flow. So far I talked about localized body forces in a given direction, but we can also apply that to passive control devices, for instance, a small control cylinder, typically accounted for with a drag force model. And those are the maps we obtain for first and second order eigenvalue variation. And they actually turn out to be pretty similar in this case. If we look at the spectrum, we see that the leading mode gets stabilized and the other modes remain stable. And zooming here, we see that the second order prediction follows or predicts very, very closely the actual path of the eigenvalue, both in terms of growth rates and frequency. We also get stabilizing regions. Here, when we only consider the first order prediction, and here with both first and second order predictions. So for a given Reynolds number, for instance, 50, we get larger stabilizing regions, and we can also restabilize the flow up to a larger Reynolds number, which seems to be in better agreement with the experimental results I showed at the beginning. Now we can also have a look at the two terms that are in the second order eigenvalue variation. You may remember I mentioned it briefly at the beginning that there are two terms, and they actually correspond to slightly different mechanisms. The first one, you see here, A2 depends on U2, the second order base flow modification, whereas this term here is an interaction between the first order base flow modification and the first order eigenmode modification. So this map that I showed before already is actually the sum of those two maps that are pretty similar, but you see that the first term, the first mechanism, can be destabilizing here close to the cylinder, whereas the second term is only stabilizing. One more thing we can look at is the following. You remember that lambda 1 and lambda 2 can be expressed like this as a product of the inner product of the control and the sensitivity. But we can also rearrange these expressions and write them as the product of the base flow modification and another sensitivity. And now if we look at those products for a particular case when when the control cylinder is located here. At first order, we actually realized that regions that contribute to stabilizing effects are located, the main stabilizing region is here in the recirculation region, and not actually close to the control cylinder itself. That was observed already by Marquet, Sip, and Jacquin. But now if you look at the second order effect, split again in two terms, one and two, we realize that stabilizing regions are immediately close to the control cylinder and in its wake. So I find it quite interesting to see the difference between those two mechanisms. And finally, I would like to talk about optimal control. So if we only consider the first order variation, the question we're asking is what's the best shape for the control so as to get, for instance, the largest stabilizing effect. If we only consider the first order prediction, one can show that the optimal control is proportional to the sensitivity itself. Conversely, if you only consider the second order variation, it's possible to show that the optimal control is solution of an eigenvalue problem. And this is relevant to situations where lambda one is zero, because then you have to go to second order if you want to predict anything. And that happens, for instance, when you have a nominally two-dimensional flow that you control with a three-dimensional flow, a three-dimensional control that's periodic in the invariant direction of the flow. Because in this case, by some averaging effect, lambda one is exactly zero. Now, if we consider both the first and the second order variations together, we have to solve this equation where beta is unknown. We get a set of betas, and the optimal control corresponds to the smallest beta. And now the result depends on the amplitude, which was not the case when we considered only the first or the second order variations. So we have this equation, and the way to solve it is to transform it into a quadratic eigenvalue problem in beta. Which is even more convenient is to transform it again into an equivalent linear eigenvalue problem, which has twice the size, but which is solvable with standard techniques. And this is what we obtain at Reynolds 50. And so the upper half of this figure here shows the optimal control for first order variation only, and the lower half is for combined first and second order. So you don't see much of a difference here for this particular control amplitude. But as we increase the control amplitude, we see that the optimal control changes slightly. So for instance, here it should be stronger close to the cylinder and weaker in the recirculation region. And this figure here on the left shows that for any control amplitude or optimization amplitude, the optimal control you get is really optimal only for that specific amplitude. For instance, look at this green curve here. It's below all the other curves here. But if you zoom in this region, you see that it's really not optimal for other amplitudes. This is by construction. But it's interesting because it means that if you know which amplitude you want to use, you can fine-tune the control so as to obtain the largest or a larger effect than considering only the first order variation. So to conclude, I will just skip that I said already, but I would like to mention the fact that the computational cost is very reasonable. It's the same as computing the first order sensitivity. So this method really has the potential, I think, to accelerate iterative optimization. So when we compute not only one sensitivity, but when we have to iterate to compute an optimal control, I think it's really interesting. And finally, I should also say that this can be applied to other eigenvalue problems, like, for instance, resolvent analysis, because the optimal gain, G, and the optimal forcing, F, are a solution of an eigenvalue problem. So we can just apply the exact same method and get the sensitivity of the gain and the control. So with that, I will be happy to take questions.